Hello students, in today's topic we will be discussing the second portion of van der Poel method, that is Hall measurements. We have already discussed what exactly is Hall effect, Hall voltage and Hall coefficient in the previous video. So let us just start with the measurements part in today's lecture. So the Hall measurements, they are carried out in the presence of magnetic field. Now van der Poel method is a method which is useful to derive four different parameters. If you only want to find out sheet resistance, the first portion of the measurements is followed, wherein magnetic field is not required. But if we want to derive what is the doping type of a material, or what is the carrier density, or what is the mobility of charge carriers, we need to apply a magnetic field along with the current. So Hall measurements, they are carried out in the presence of magnetic field. They can yield carrier density, which we denote as NS, doping type. What do you mean by doping type? Whether the material is an N-type material or it is a P-type material. That means whether it is doped by pentavalent impurities or whether it is doped by trivalent impurities. Once you determine the doping type, the mobility of charge carriers can also be determined using Hall measurements. The Hall voltage for a thick, heavily doped sample can be very, very small as microvolts. So there is a difficulty to get accurate results. So what exactly happens in this case? What is done is two sets of Hall measurements are taken. There can be a large offset due to non-symmetric contact placement also. To avoid the above two problems, we take two different sets of measurements, that is one keeping the magnetic field in positive direction, the other keeping it in negative direction. Let's see what exactly is done. Suppose I say that this is the sample taken. Like the previous part of the method, the van der Poel method, four different contacts are made. The contacts should be made at the edges only. The sample should be homogeneous. Thickness should be very, very less. So all the points we discussed in van der Poel method are repeated here. But there is one additional thing which happens, and that is this magnetic field. You can see this is in the direction perpendicular to the direction of current. The current is along the x-axis and the magnetic field is along the z-axis. So this is the coordinate system which we have considered, denoting this as positive x, this side negative x, positive z, positive y, and inside it negative y. So we have current in the x direction and magnetic field in the positive z direction. So in this case, what is done, unlike the earlier method, here only two different combinations are done. You can see the diagonal measurements are done. In the previous method we had adjacent measurements, but here we take diagonal measurements. Diagonal as in inject the current through one, take it out from three. So one loop is like this, injecting from one, taking out from three. The other will be injecting in three, taking out from one. Then what we do is we just swap this emitter. The current meter is connected between 2 and 4. So there also we have two possibilities. Inject through 2, take out from 4. So it will be 2 to 4. The other possibility, 4 to 2. So in the description below I have mentioned I13 means the DC current injected into contact 1 and taken out from contact 3. Injected in 1, taken out from 3. We represent it as I13. Similarly, we can measure I31, we can measure I24, we can measure I42. B is the constant and uniform magnetic field intensity. Positive means if this B is pointing in the positive Z direction. And negative will be if we reverse the magnetic field and if it points the negative Z direction, we will be considering it as negative. Now for whenever the magnetic field is in the positive Z direction, the voltage we measure, we will denote it as P. P stands for positive. So Hall voltage, see, current is injected between 1 and 3. Current is injected between 1 and 3. So voltage is measured across 2 and 4. So we denote that as V24P stands for Hall voltage measured between leads 2 and 4 with positive magnetic field for I13. Similarly, we can measure V42P, V13P, V31P. And then when we reverse the magnetic field, that is when we apply in negative Z direction, we get V24 instead of P, V24N, V42N, V13N, V31N. Getting it? So this is what we have considered, and now we move on to the measurements part. In this portion, we have just given the steps and then we derive the actual equation. So apply a positive magnetic field B, magnetic field in positive z direction. Then current is injected, a DC current is injected, that is I13. So injected from 1, taken out from 3. And that is between the leads 1 and 3. And the voltage is measured as V24P. That is the first step. Now what is done? So apply the current and measure the voltage. Next, what is done? Reverse the current. Inject from 3, take out from 1. So in that case, voltage is again measured between 2 and 4 only. But for 1-3, we have used V24. So for I31, we will be using V42P. So now apply the current I31 and measure the voltage V42. So we had two different currents and two different voltage measurements done. Similarly, we can measure V13P, V31P for I24 and I42 respectively. What does that mean? In this above diagram, if we just take out the current source from 1 and 3 and we connect between 2 and 4, then what will we have? Voltage measurement between 1 and 3. So we can take another set of measurements. Now reverse the magnetic field and take all the four measurements again. Which four measurements? We had V24P, V42P, V13P, V31P. So total four voltage measurements with B in positive direction. Now we reverse the direction of B. So all these four measurements will be taken again and they will be denoted as V24N, V42N, V13N, V31N. So the above eight measurements of Hall voltages, again I'm repeating V24P, V42P, V31P, V13P, V24N, V42N, V31N, V13N, they determine the sample type. These voltages that have been measured will tell us whether the material is a P-type material or it is an N-type material. And once this is derived, the Hall mobility and sheet density also can be determined if the sheet resistance is known. So the first part of Van der Poel method will yield sheet resistance and this part will yield Hall mobility, sheet density and doping type. And now let us see how the Hall calculations are done. We measured four different voltages, two sets of four voltages, one with B positive, the other with B negative. So the difference of voltages for the positive and negative fields need to be worked out. So if I say V13, voltage between the contacts 1 and 3 will be the difference between positive magnetic field voltage measured and negative magnetic field voltage measured. So V13P minus V13N. Similarly, V24 will be V24P minus V24N. V31 will be V31P minus V31N. V42 will be V42P minus V42N. So this will give us four voltages and the average of them. So 13 plus 31 plus V24 plus V42 divided by 4 will give us the value of Hall voltage, which is denoted as VH. Now just see in this above calculation part, we have randomly taken P minus N, that can be a negative value also. So this polarity of the Hall voltage, so suppose I get this as negative, I get this as negative, right? So the value of VH we get, the average value of VH can either be negative or positive. So the polarity of the Hall voltage indicates the type of material. That means if we get the value of VH here as positive, if the magnitude of VH is positive, we say the material is a P-type material. And if the average of VH we are getting a negative value, we say that the material is an N-type material. So if the magnitude of Hall voltage is negative, the material is N-type. So this is how the part of determining doping type is done. Now once the doping has been determined, The sheet density can also be calculated. So remember, in the previous video, we had derived the equation of VH as IB upon QNS. So using the same equation, we have to derive NS, that is the sheet density. What do you mean by sheet density? It denotes the number of charge carriers in a certain volume multiplied by thickness. We denote NS as N into T. So NS will be IB. Now these two are known. I is the current we have used. B is the magnetic field we have applied. Q is the charge of electron. And VH is the voltage which we measure for a particular sample. So using this equation, we can derive what is the sheet density of that particular sample. So part 2 done. Now let us find out how to calculate mobility using the above method. You know the standard equation between conductivity, the relation between conductivity and mobility, sigma is equals to any mu, or you can denote nq mu, where q here stands for charge of an electron. Using this equation, mu is equals to sigma upon nq, but you know that conductivity is the inverse of resistivity. So we can write mu as 1 upon rho nq. Sigma is substituted as 1 upon rho. So mu will be 1 upon. Now we know that rho, that is resistivity of a sample, is equals to sheet resistance into thickness. So it can be written as Rs into T, N and Q as it is. Now this term, just see this, T into N, that is equals to sheet density. So NT is equals to NS. We have just derived using the above equation. So mu will be 1 upon Rs Ns Q. How do you find out Rs? Using the resistivity measurement, that is part 1 of Van der Poel method. Ns we have just now derived, and Q is the charge of electron. So using this, you can find out mobility of the sample also, mobility of the charge carriers. So if it is an n-type material, mobility will be of electrons. If it is a p-type material, mobility will be of holes. Now advantages. Only 4 contacts are required. No need to measure the sample width or distance between contacts. So any distance between the contacts or samples is not required, and only 4 contacts need to be made. You need only a current source and only a voltmeter, and a magnetic field is applied. So overall arrangement is simple. But what are the disadvantages of the method? Measurement takes twice as long because you have to take one set of measurements using B positive and the other set of measurements using magnetic field as negative direction. And the errors due to contact size and placement can be significant. If the contacts are made sufficiently large or if they are not exactly placed at the edges, the voltage which is measured will be incorrect. So if the voltage is incorrect, sheet density will not be proper and the mobility will also not be accurate. So there can be disadvantages, but they can be overcome if you properly make the contacts. So this is all about Van der Poel method part 2, basis on which we derived doping type, sheet density and mobility. Now let us move on to a very small and a very easy method, which is known as the hot probe method. This is a method which is useful for quickly determining whether the semiconductor is N-type or P-type. You can only determine the doping type using hot probe method, nothing else, right? Only whether the sample is P-type or N-type. Why exactly we require this method? Just before designing the P-N junction, you can determine whether the material is P-type or N-type. So what exactly is the method? You take this as a sample. On the sample, only 2 contacts are made. Unlike the Van der Poel method, these contacts can be placed anywhere. So in the center, we have done 2 contacts. 2 probes are connected. And 2 probes, out of this, 1 probe is hot probe. What does that mean? This contact, using this probe, is heated. You can use a soldering iron also to heat. The other contact is kept at room temperature. I repeat again, this contact is heated using a normal source such as a soldering iron, and this is kept at room temperature. So comparatively, I can say that this is the hot probe and this is the colder one. In between them, you can either connect an emitter, a micro emitter, or you can connect a voltmeter. How can this simple arrangement determine whether the sample is p-type or n-type? So let us just go through the two diagrams below. Suppose I say this is the hotter junction connected with the soldering iron. What happens if you connect a soldering iron to this contact? The contact temperature will get increased. Suppose we assume that this is an n-type material. So it will be having more number of electrons. We are just assuming that this is an n-type material, right? So if this contact is being heated up, all the majority carriers near the contact will gain kinetic energy. In this case, if it is an n-type material, it will be electrons. So kinetic energy of electrons will increase, and these electrons will try to move towards the colder junction because heat always flows from higher to lower temperature. So suppose electrons are moving from this side to this side, your galvanometer or the emitter you have connected will show the deflection like this. Because if electrons are moving, this side is becoming positive and this side is becoming negative. So you will be getting a deflection in the direction of electrons, means your material is n-type. Let us assume the material is a p-type material. So suppose if this is a p-type material, the hotter junction will be having more number of holes. And if these holes are moving towards the colder junction, so if holes are moving towards the colder junction, that means colder side is becoming positive and the hotter side is becoming negative, your deflection will be in the opposite direction. Carriers are moving like this, but deflection is opposite. So if the direction is opposite, it's a p-type material. If it is in the same direction, it is n-type material. This is what I have written here. The diffusion of charge carriers causes current flow. The net current will depend on the majority of charge carriers, electrons for n-type and holes for p-type. If the carriers are negative, the current flow will be in the same direction. And if the carriers are positive, the current flow will be in the opposite direction. There is one more way to understand this method. Instead of a micro emitter, if you connect a voltmeter, the polarity of the voltmeter also indicates whether the material is p-type or n-type. Now suppose we again assume that this is an n-type material. What will happen if n-type material means electrons are moving towards the colder side? Why? Because they are in excess. So if electrons are moving away from the hot junction is becoming positive. So polarity of your voltmeter will be positive on the hotter side and negative on the colder side, means the material is n-type. On the other hand, if your material is a p-type material, so the hotter side will be having more number of holes. These holes move towards the colder side. So hotter side, holes are moving, means hotter side is becoming negative and the colder side is becoming positive. So we say that your voltmeter polarity is negative on the hot side, positive on the cold side. So if this is the case, your material is p-type. So we can say that polarity of sample can be determined either by direction of deflection in the current meter or by the polarity of voltage measured. Hope this clarifies the topic. Thank you.